Now let's talk about classes of drugs. Depressants. These result in sedation. They are central nervous system depressants. Hence the name. They will make you sleepy. They will make you go to sleep. They will also make you sleep for hours upon hours, and they can also kill you in high enough doses. Barbiturates, just asterisk there for your own knowledge. Thank you for coming today. I appreciate your presence. Hypnotics, sedatives are those benzodiazepines, are barbiturates. Valium and Zantac are what are called benzos, benzodiazepines. And alcohol. Alcohol is a depressant. Now, most people see people drink alcohol and they're like, woo! And they're having a damn fine time. They don't seem depressed and they don't seem sleepy. But you add enough alcohol, you're going to sleep. You're going to pass out. And then you may die. If you pass out because you have so much alcohol in your system, you may retch. You may vomit. But if you're passed out, you are non-responsive. You are unconscious by definition, and that's how people choke on their own vomit. So if you see anybody passed out, please don't let them lie on their back. Please turn them over and put an arm underneath their head so that they, if they do vomit, it projects out and clears the airway. That's an uncommon thing because people don't often drink at those high levels, but it does demonstrate it is a depressant. It depresses respiration, it depresses bodily activity, it depresses consciousness. You may black out before you pass out. And a blackout, your body's still up doing all kinds of crazy shit you would never, ever do if you were sober, but you'll have no memory of it, which is why it's called a blackout. But sooner or later, you're going to go to sleep, and you'll probably sleep for quite a while as you have the effects of alcohol wear off, right? And then you wake up to a hangover, which is that opponent process, where the body is going in the opposite direction of what the drug did. So those drugs are central nervous system depressants, and they have effects that kind of go along with the class of drug name. Stimulants, woo! Up, 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 up! Behavioral activity, alertness, mood, elevation, amphetamines, pseudoephedrine, methamphetamine, crank, cocaine, nicotine, caffeine. Nicotine's a mild stimulant. It can also be a sedative in the sense that people who are addicted to nicotine have withdrawal symptoms pretty regularly throughout the day and can get really agitated and really irritated, which would make it hard to sleep. And so those people who were dependent on nicotine might actually smoke a cigarette and calm down enough to go to sleep as they abate the nicotine withdrawal, right? But for most people, it's a mild stimulant. Caffeine, it's a mild stimulant. Now, you take 50 milligrams of caffeine, if you're sensitive to it, you might get a little bit of an elevation in mood, an elevation in alertness. But if you're really sensitive to caffeine, 200, 250 milligrams might make you feel jittery and uncomfortable. 500 milligrams, 1,000 milligrams, could you even take that? Certainly, if you became tolerant to it over time. I know people and have been myself one of those people, I can drink a heavily caffeinated beverage and go to sleep because I'm so tolerant to the drug that it doesn't really affect me in the way that it affects people who are not tolerant to the drug. But you do have withdrawals if you come off the drug, right? If you quit caffeine dependence, you will have headaches and irritability for a couple of days. That's the physiological dependence that you go through coming through the withdrawal. But then psychologically, you still have this kind of sense of, man, I wish I had a cup of coffee. I drink tea and other kinds of caffeinated beverages, but you have this sense that you want it, even though technically you're not physiologically dependent upon it anymore. And that is a powerful craving. Psychological notwithstanding, it's still a powerful effect. Cocaine and other kinds of things are really potentially dangerous. I've seen a lot of people use them responsibly, believe it or not. But I've seen people use them irresponsibly and become dangerous to themselves and others. And they are hard people to hang around with, unless you're doing it with them, in which case they all seem to get along with each other quite well. Talking about nothing. Noses be running and all kind of. Opiates. We talked about those. Those are those derived from the opium poppy. So there are natural derivatives of the opium poppy, certain opium varieties, not all of them. You may have heard of people who've had false positive drug tests who've never used opiates but had been eating opium or poppy seeds on bagels and other kinds of things. So there's similar molecular structure, but it's inactive, inert, psychoactively, they don't get high off of them, but it can be detected accidentally by drug tests, and that's a hard thing to prove that you weren't doing heroin or something like that when all you've been doing is eating poppy seeds. They result in analgesia. Analgesia is pain reduction. That's why it's used in chronic cases of pain and acute cases of pain, because it helps to make the pain go away. Analgesia is not the kind that comes with, say, a, epidural. Epidural, I don't know if you've ever watched delivery of a baby or the contractions that go with that. My God, women, thank you. Again, what you endure for our species is stunning. And I'm kind of glad I don't have to go through that. I've seen it, and it looks awfully painful. And I've seen it erased by the administration of an epidural, where all that's felt is no longer pain, but pressure. And what's happening there is the afferent neurons, the sensory neurons that carry the pain signal to the brain. What is pain but an idea that you have about the signals you're receiving from neurons that are telling you something's going wrong, right? Whether it's a headache or whether it's a laceration or a bone break or whatever it is, you're getting repeated signals that something's horribly wrong, and that's what we call hurting. But as I said before, you can get a state of consciousness where you're working. I was playing a gig the other night, jamming, having a good time, getting really into it. And I cut my finger somehow, some way. I didn't notice it until later when all that distraction went away. And I rubbed my finger. I was like, ow, what is that? Oh, look at that. I cut myself. I didn't even notice that I did it. But had I taken my finger, looked at it, and taken a scalpel and done exactly the same thing while I was watching it, guarantee it would hurt. Because there's no ignoring the signal. Well, epidural is actually dampening the signal being sent by the neuron that's registering pain, so the brain doesn't get the signal, so that there is no experience of pain. Whereas opiates, as analgesics, actually don't stop pain signals. They make you so high you don't give a damn about being in pain anymore. In other words, they create dissociation. People's consciousnesses are somewhat disconnected from the experience of pain. I had a case when I had my tonsils out. Now, having big hunks of tissue ripped out of the back of your throat hurts badly, because you have to swallow, because you can't avoid that, and you have to breathe, and you can't avoid that, and it really is agitating. And back in the day when that happened, I was in my late teens, and I got my mom's Percocets, which were left over from some other thing, because she didn't abuse drugs, but I did. Right, and I had Tylenol codeine 3. So I had two sources of codeine, and I used a lot of it. And for 2 or 3 days, I had this nature tape playing. And it was like I was in the jungle. I was just totally zoned out. Yeah, I hurt, but I didn't care, because I wasn't paying attention until I ran out of codeine, and then it hurt. It hurt a lot. It wasn't that the pain signals had stopped. It's that the opiates had created a sense of dissociation, a euphoria, a high that distracted you from the experience of pain. So that's different. Causes drowsiness. So I slept a lot in those couple days as well. Causes euphoria. You feel really good while also feeling really bad. So you have that counterbalance. This includes heroin, opium, codeine, morphine, and the synthetics. And the synthetics are just made in labs. They're the same type of molecular structures that you would find in opiates, but they've just been chemically created by people. And so you could create all kinds of molecules, and that's also a side effect of having all drugs but a couple illegal, and that is that people just make, in today's age, new drugs. They make new molecules, some of which can be very dangerous. So they experiment chemically with all manner of substances that may not have ever been experimented with if those other ones were available and controlled and rational fashions. That's drugs of abuse for you. People will abuse drugs when they have problems with drugs. Hallucinogens do exactly what they sound like they do. Hallucinations, alterations in sensory perception, possible delusions. Lysergic acid diethylamide is what most people call acid. Lysergic acid diethylamide 25. It's a synthetic type of version of the ergot fungus, or byproduct of the ergot fungus, which occurs naturally in wheat, such that it's even been suggested that some of the witch trials In the Middle Ages, might have been actual cases of mass contamination of wheat where entire towns might have been exposed to hallucinogenic substances, hallucinated, had delusions, and lacking any kind of scientific basis for understanding that, it made perfect sense that they must be possessed by evil spirits or in consort with the devil. Because the types of things that happen on hallucinogens when one is hallucinating is unlike anything that's ever happened to them before. It can be an epiphany. It can be a religious experience. Or it can be horrifying and terrifying, depending on the user's expectancy effects, the doses they take, and the set and the setting they find themselves in over the course of being under the influence of that drug. Psilocybin mushrooms, or what people call shrooms, those are naturally found growing on cow shit. So people go out looking for it because they like to get high on these mushrooms. Psilocybin is the active ingredient. Peyote is a cactus, and it's been used in Native American rituals and other Mesoamerican rituals in spiritual use as part of a spiritual practice, a sanctioned cultural practice in which responsibility is paramount, but where visions occur and people see those as very significant. But it can also be used as a drug of abuse or recreationally, and the active ingredient is mescaline. PCP and other related types of drugs, those are drugs that cause some pretty dramatic departures from reality, and that's the people you see on Cops running around naked, body sweating, and it takes 10 people to take them down because they are jacked up and they are seeing shit. And it's scary for them and everybody around them. And you can't stop them. You have to go through extraordinary means because they have disconnected from reality. And that's some of the potential here. So some of the potential is not so much the actual dosage. To my knowledge, you can't overdose on lysergic acid diethylamide 25. It's dosed in micrograms. But you could certainly go insane while you take it and do some crazy stuff that gets you killed, right? Marijuana ingested in relatively large amounts. Now, marijuana is a hard drug to classify. The way I was talking about it before, I'm talking about marijuana as it's smoked. Marijuana as it's smoked does not seem to have any toxicity level. Most people are able to tolerate it fairly well. Some people have panic attacks on it. And so there's all kinds of possibilities there that you can see. But in Colorado, there have been 2 deaths now linked to marijuana use. But it's not to the amount of marijuana they smoked. It was because when you eat it, it's hallucinogenic. And you have to eat it in fairly high amounts. And what happened is the people, at least one of them, the story I heard, was that they ate one part of a 6-part food product that was laced with marijuana intentionally and was told you should only have one of these, didn't feel an immediate effect, so ate the other 5 thinking, well, I didn't get anything out of it. Well, got something out of it and went off a balcony. So it wasn't that the THC was an overdose and killed them as a drug effect. It was that their response to THC in that format was so intense that they weren't ready for it and it caused them to do something that killed them.